Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. We're going to do some microbiology basics and start with a quick little introduction to microbiology. So what is microbiology? It's the study of organisms that are so small they cannot be seen with the naked eye. That's why it's micro, small, right? And even though we actually also include in that organisms that can't be seen with the naked eye, such as tapeworms and roundworms, generally, the bulk of what we study is very tiny and requires a microscope to view. So microorganisms or microbes are single-cell animals that are found throughout nature, and they can interact in the life cycles of humans and other life forms, such as, you know, plants and animals. I do want to also take a moment to make a side note here that in microbiology, we also study viruses, and viruses are not single-celled animals. But we do include them in microbiology because viruses can enter cells and then take over the cells and command cells. And so they can affect cell function. And so we include them in microbiology. So what are viruses? Viruses are genetic material that is wrapped in a protein core. That's pretty much what viruses are. So microbiology then can be divided into different fields of study that's based on the type of microorganism that is being examined. So we have bacteriology is the study of bacteria, mycology is the study of fungi, virology is the study of viruses, and parasitology is the study of parasites. Couple of other terms you need to know. Normal flora, now really referred to as the microbiome. Those are the microorganisms that normally live on or in the human body and under normal circumstances do not cause disease. For example, you have E. coli in the colon, and it's there. It has a very helpful role there. It's supposed to be there. But if that E. coli enters into the bladder, then it can cause a urinary tract infection. And so it would not normally cause disease, but if it's in the wrong environment, it can cause disease. And then pathogens are disease-causing microorganisms. And this is what we usually are concerned with in clinical microbiology, because it's what affects our patients, it's what causes disease, makes patients sick, is what we need to treat. So we are concerned about identifying pathogens, although there is a whole branch of science that has been dedicated to the study of the microbiome and how it changes in different chronic conditions. And for example, like what it looks like in an autistic patient versus what it looks like in a patient that has diabetes versus a healthy person. And what can we do maybe to change the microbiome? What organisms are helpful? What could we add to help in the treatment of certain diseases that are not infectious diseases, that are things such as diabetes or autism? So when a patient presents with a certain set of symptoms of a disease, and the doctor suspects that this might be a microbiological infection, then we have to identify the causative agent. And that then allows a physician to successfully treat the patient, so to match the treatment to the infection. So to help achieve this goal, then an appropriate specimen has to be collected in a sterile container and sent to the lab as soon as possible, where it will be processed immediately and testing will begin. Information that is sent to the laboratory with a specimen should include, and this should be on the specimen also, patient demographics, so that's often name, date of birth, medical record number, usually sample number, date and time it was ordered, and then you also want the sample source, so what type of sample is this? And this, it might seem obvious, but just to let you know, like, not every yellow fluid is urine. Maybe it's peritoneal fluid, okay? So it's very important to indicate the sample source and the date and time that sample was collected, because it's possible that more than one sample that looks similar will be collected and then be collected at different times, Or maybe a physician has ordered a series of three collections of the same type of specimen. So it's important to indicate the date and time of collection, and that should be indicated on the specimen. So you should have no doubt whose specimen it is, what the specimen is, what's the sample source, and when it was collected. So what types of specimens can we get in the lab for microbiology testing? So the first one is sputum. So sputum is a material from deep within the respiratory tract. So we're talking about bronchi or lungs, right? So we're looking at diagnosing different types of bronchitis and pneumonia. An early morning specimen is best, usually because the patient's been sleeping and resting and things have been maybe accumulating in the lungs. And if you get them moving, they can get to coughing and get that out. And then that would be a good specimen, hopefully with plenty of the bacteria or microorganisms in there for us to identify. So deep coughing usually will yield a good sample. You want something that's coming from deep within the lungs. You don't want just spit, and you don't want this specimen to be heavily contaminated with saliva, because we have bacteria in our mouth and that could throw some of the testing off. And so you don't want the patient to just go, psh, psh, you know, and spit in a cup. No, you want the stuff that's coming from inside their lungs. The respiratory therapist can often assist with the collection of sputum samples because they come around and do the respiratory treatments and breathing treatments, which often can knock loose some of the stuff where the patients can cough it up, and it, you know, makes it easier to get a specimen that way. So next is urine. So urine is fluid from the bladder that is normally sterile. An early morning specimen is best for the same reason that early morning sputum is best. The urine has been sitting in the bladder. If there's an infection and microorganisms are present, they have had plenty of time to multiply and there to be a significant amount of bacteria in there. And so depending on your patient, if your patient is ambulatory, can get up and go to the bathroom, or if they're bedbound, you can either do a clean catch midstream sample if they're ambulatory, or a catheterized urine sample if they're bedbound and they can't get up and you want to make sure that what you get is sterile. If they have an indwelling catheter, then it's important to collect urine that's coming high up on the catheter, that's just coming out of that bladder, and to not use the urine that's been collecting in that collection bag that's probably not been emptied for hours. And so that's not an ideal specimen. You want the freshest formed urine as possible. Then blood. So blood is really important due to the critical nature of this type of infection, meaning that if a physician is ordering blood culture, they are suspecting that the patient might have sepsis. So the infection, wherever it's present, if it's present in their lungs or the kidneys, or wherever, where it's a really deep wound, has crossed over into the bloodstream, and then it can go anywhere in the body and it can cause a lot of problems. So to collect blood for a culture, there's special blood collecting equipment and techniques that are used to avoid contaminating the venous blood with skin contaminants. And this is, we want to avoid skin contaminants of the patient, but also of the phlebotomist, the collector, the nurse. We want to clean everything very thoroughly. If we're drawing the specimen from an indwelling line, we want to make sure that we clean the ports and everything is thoroughly clean before we collect the sample, and we use absolutely as much as possible sterile technique. Typically, we draw two sets of blood culture bottles, and they contain nutrient broth, and they're drawn 30 minutes apart from two separate sites, venipuncture sites. So you see in the picture here, these bottles, there's an orange one and a green one, and they represent an anaerobic and an aerobic bottle. And so one of each of those is a typical set of blood cultures, and we would want to draw two sets of those, again, 30 minutes apart. And a typical sample volume for one of these is 5 mils. 5 mils is good. That's enough. And so if you can get 10 mils of blood, you can put half of it in one bottle and half of it in the other bottle. And that's one set of blood cultures. And then 30 minutes later, you get a different venipuncture site and you repeat the process. And if the patient has an indwelling line, the nursing staff can draw one set of blood cultures from that line also, and while the phlebotomist draws another set from an arm, let's say, site. So next we have cerebrospinal fluid. It's a normally sterile protective nourishing fluid that circulates around the brain and the spinal cord. The physician collects this specimen using a lumbar puncture, and the tubes to collect spinal fluid are sterile and are numbered 1 through 4. And it's important to collect them in that correct order and to properly label them, and then also not delay rapidly bringing them to the lab and notifying the lab that they have a spinal fluid so that they can begin testing immediately, because we don't want to leave that specimen sitting there because we might lose some of the microbes in there because they're really sensitive to environmental changes. This would be to detect meningitis, which is also, you know, quite threatening to the health of the patient. So we want to properly diagnose meningitis and get all the testing done right. This is not the type of specimen that can be easily recollected. And so we have to make sure that everything is done correctly to get an accurate diagnosis on the patient. Next, we have stool. So a stool sample normally has a lot of bacteria in it, which is part of the normal flora or its normal microbiome. And so we would order a stool culture and plate in it in such a way that we are looking for specific pathogenic enteric microorganisms, things like we're looking for a salmonella infection or a shigella infection. And stool cultures should be set up within 2 hours of specimen collection. And stool specimen can also be collected to check for the presence of parasites. And they have their own collection container, or we have to usually put the stool into a specific container for that and send them off. Stools can also be used for antigen testing and PCR testing. So the antigen testing, for example, for C. diff, that's a pretty common one. And so it doesn't require the culturing of the specimen, but it's a quick test and it yields a positive negative results for the presence of C. diff. And then the PCR test can usually check for a bunch of different pathogenic bacteria, parasites, viruses in the stool by looking for the genetic material. So that's a pretty cool way to test this stool sample. And then lastly, we have swabs. So swabs are used to collect material for cultures from various openings of the body, such as the nose, throat, vagina, anus, and wounds. So swabs have to be put in transport media before they're taken to the lab. And that's just depending on the testing requirements. So if there's going to be any kind of delay in testing, it's usually better to put it in transport media. Some types of tests, you can accept dry swabs, especially if it's going to be tested right away. So for that, just follow the procedures and protocols of your particular lab. What is important to know is improperly handled swabs could lead to the specimen being deemed as unacceptable. What is really, really important with the swabs is not only to properly label it with all the patient demographic information, but to indicate where that swab came from. Because if one person collects a swab from the nose for a flu test, while another person collects on the same patient a throat swab for a strep test, and neither one of them labels them as nose swab for flu or throat swab for strep, the lab gets two identical swabs with the same patient information. How do they know which one's which, right? And so same thing if the patient has multiple wounds and you're swabbing a wound for a wound culture, and you have to be able to identify, is this the wound on their right leg or left butt cheek or something like that. So swabs, because we can use them for so many different areas, it's really, 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 really important to indicate what you swabbed, at what time, and who on whom before it is sent to the lab. All right, so that wraps up. That's the last of the types of specimens. We're going to continue this microbiology basic series in the next video, and I appreciate you guys' attention.